Yeah, book by book. Here we are. I'm Richard Bewes, welcoming you to the Quinter Centre. It's a Christian centre here in Shropshire, England. And I'm joined here by Paul Blackham, my old colleague, and also by our special guest for this particular series, and that is George Verwer, who is founder of Operation Mobilisation, that ferries Christian resources and Bibles and everything else right out to the whole world. And welcome, George, very much. We're glad to see you today.
Great to be back again.
Wonderful. We're doing the book of Proverbs, and what we're going to do now is to, well, first of all, in this first study, we look at chapters 1 to 3. So why don't we just read from chapter 1 right away. The Proverbs of Solomon, son of David, king of Israel, for attaining wisdom and discipline, for understanding words of insight, for acquiring a disciplined and prudent life, doing what is right and just and fair, for giving prudence to the simple, knowledge and discretion to the young, the wise listen. And verse 7, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and discipline. So, first of all, well, George, I think you know this book well. Why has this book of the Bible been so important to you over the years?
It's an amazing story, but I was selling Christian books door to door in my home area shortly after my conversion. I was very young, and I was trying to go to Mexico. I think we were trying to earn some money and get Christian books out at the same time. This one lady just bought a lot of books, but I think looking at me, she realized I was probably big on zeal and weak on wisdom. So she invited me into the house, I'll never forget it, and said, young man, do you study the book of Proverbs? I don't know what I answered her, but I don't think I'd got that far yet. And then she said, you know, young man, a proverb a day will keep the devil away.
Oh, wow.
She's
wow,
trying to scare me.
Yeah.
And then she showed 31 proverbs, one for every day in the month. And that's over 50 years ago. But because of her, and because it was such a help and blessing to me, I've been reading the Proverbs almost every day all these 50-some years. So I thank the Lord for that lady. And everywhere I go in the world, I challenge young people, anybody, to try to read the Proverbs every day. Read the Psalms, then go back and read the Proverbs every day. It doesn't take long. And so this is really very special that now I can do this series with you guys on this great book.
Oh, that's a great start to our little series, I must say. And of course, stemming as they do, well, many of them from King Solomon. And when he was first made the king, he met God in a dream. We read that in 1 Kings chapter 3. And the Lord says to him, what would you like me to give you? And Solomon says, I'm just a child. I lack so much. So I need an understanding heart. And the Lord is pleased with him and says, I will give you, this is 1 Kings 3:12, I will give you wisdom and discernment. And that very thing happens, at least for much of his life, most of his life. So this theme, repent, actually, is highlighted a great deal in this chapter when verse 14, I see here, when the readers, they're warned not to go along with throwing their lot in with, well, what I, as a missionary's child from Kenya, I remember as the Happy Valley set. And they were a group of settlers in Kenya who were just out there to make Kenya their playground. And that was all it was. Well, the first nine chapters here are David instructing Solomon on how to be a wise king. So when we think, we could say, you see, that as we look at these chapters where the father is instructing the son, we could see the key truth that as David instructed his son Solomon, so the Father sends the Son Jesus Christ to display wisdom for us. So when we think of that, maybe that helps us to approach this book. What do you think, Paul?
I do think so, because there's that wonderful way in which we don't really realise what a mess we're making of life always until we see how it's supposed to be. And then when we see how how wonderful the Lord Jesus lives his life, that displayed to us, then you sort of often think, oh, that's what life should be like. That's how it's supposed to be. And I think here at the beginning of the book of Proverbs, there's a way in which wisdom calls out and says to us all, really, everybody, turn around. Stop going these foolish and destructive ways. Turn around and come to the fear of the Lord and trust in the Lord. And there's that turn around, repent. That's what repent means. And it's interesting that the Lord Jesus, in Matthew 4:17, the very first sermon he preached was repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And some people think, oh, that's a very negative message. It isn't really. He's saying, look, you're going into death and destruction and wasting your life. Turn around, because the kingdom of heaven's right here. You don't, it doesn't matter how bad you've been or what a mess you've made. I will forgive you, and I'll take you on as my disciple, and I'll bring you into the kingdom of God, and I'll teach you wisdom. And I love it that it's new every morning is his mercies, because we might go, oh, I've made such a mess, I'm so unwise. He still holds out his hands and says, come, turn around, I will forgive you and teach you a way of wisdom. And that's how the book of Proverbs begins, to just give us that warning and welcome it, like, or command us to come in. I love that beginning. It's like the Sermon on the Mount in a way, that after Jesus had said, repent, the kingdom of heaven is at hand, very soon after, he sets out his wisdom.
There's such a tie-up between the two, the Sermon on the Mount and Proverbs.
Indeed. Such a tie-up, the way this sort of describing what it is to live like a citizen of the kingdom of heaven, but always welcoming us in, no matter how much we feel we've failed.
Oh, George, you've seen this, of course, across the years, right through all of the work of Operation Mobilization and the ships, and so on, bringing the words of wisdom to, millions of people.
Yeah.
It's wonderful.
I was especially helped by one of the first Wycliffe translators that very same summer. Later in the summer, we were in Mexico City, really didn't know fully what we were doing. And again, a Wycliffe Bible translator, John Beekman, was showing love to us, and he took it out to see the Mexican pyramids. And I'll never forget, again, he probably saw a lot of zeal, maybe lack of wisdom. And so he said to me, and never forget it, he said, well, George, what do you think of the whole area of common sense? And that really stuck with me as God began to lead me, especially when I got to Europe, to help birth this movement, that we needed that combination of dynamic spirituality in all of its aspects, but we also need down-to-earth common sense. And there's a lot of that in the book of Proverbs, and I believe it's often neglected today. One of the traps we see people fall in is different forms of super spirituality. And in OM, we got into some of it. And people may seem to be getting blessed. It's a bit of a mystery, but people get hurt. So I just love the practical advice. My favorite verse, of course, here is in chapter 3. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not to your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to him, and he will make your path straight. But I appreciated what you wrote about that. That doesn't mean this isn't pushing our mind to one side. It's just showing that balance, what this book is all about. That in the end, we have all this practical wisdom. We need to be as wise as we can, analyze situations. But in the end, we've got to trust in the Lord. And this verse has helped me because I had a lot of struggle with anxiety and all kinds of things. And I just again, memorized that, of course, many years ago.
Oh, my word, yes. And, well, of course, it's been a lifetime work that you've been involved in. Look at verse 22 of chapter 1, friends, because we could ask ourselves why life is divided up so sharply between the wise and the foolish ways. So wisdom, verse 22, is calling on the foolish to repent and turn away from the bloodthirsty and selfish fools. Actually, is life really such a sharp choice between wisdom and foolishness? Between the fear of the Lord and mocking fools. What do you think, George?
Well, it just comes to my mind that one of the saddest things in our day, and we experience it here in Britain, I was at a prayer breakfast in London just yesterday morning, a small one, that, you know, we're not allowed to use this kind of terminology anymore. We're not allowed to say, that, you know, this guy, he's basically evil. I mean, you might get arrested for saying that. But, you know, Proverbs is very, very clear that there is a lot of evil in the political realm. Sometimes it gets into the religious realm. We see it in the newspaper almost every day. And I just thank the Lord for the straightforward bluntness of the book of Proverbs to paint it as it really is. And the word repent also is no longer acceptable. Even some churches don't mention repent, but it's clearly a biblical principle, and it leads to continuous revival, which we get so many people praying for revival, but I believe revival is Jesus living in us. And through obedience to the word and steps of faith, we experience practical revival. I know some people think I'm exaggerating. I've experienced that kind of revival every day since my conversion. I've never missed a day. I've had miserable hours, but because of the blood of Jesus and repentance, you know, I go to bed each night, the clear conscience, revived by Jesus. And this is what we need, I believe, among God's people today.
And I like the way you referred to the word repent, because, I'm looking at two...
It's not very pleasant, is it, really?
No, it isn't. It's like the word adulteress.
Oh, dear. Yeah,
you see, in chapter 2, verse 16, I will save you also from the adulteress. So following wisdom brings true treasure, evidently. But then following the, quote, adulteress brings destruction, as though life is a sort of marriage between either wisdom or adultery. Why is that theme so strong here?
Well, it's not just Proverbs. It comes for the whole Bible, doesn't it? And I love it in Ephesians 5 where Paul's reminding us of the creation of Adam and Eve and marriage was how that design right at the beginning. And then he says, of course, I'm really talking about Christ and the church. And that we were designed for that relationship, to be married to the living God. So that when we see adultery and a person's unfaithful to someone else, they're supposed to be committed and faithful and loving and showing that love in action to somebody that they're married to. And then they turn away from that and give that love to somebody else who it's not supposed to be there. That the Lord God constantly through Scripture, yeah. Book of Hosea particularly, he's saying... Do you see how bad that is and what destruction and heartache that causes? Think about that, says the Lord, because that's what's going on in your relationship with me. That when you go this way of foolishness and you give yourself to wickedness and foolishness and selfishness, there's destruction and it is like adultery. And that when we do that and turn away from the Lord, we may actually commit adultery in earthly terms. When we don't care about love and purity and righteousness, well then it begins in our head, as Jesus says. It's the way you look at people, you lust after them, it goes down into your heart and eventually will end in action.
And what we'll do is we'll take up that theme later in another study about the whole realm of purity. From repentance then, why don't we turn to the theme of trusting in the Lord through the verse that you just mentioned a moment ago, George, verses 5 and 6 in chapter 3. They've always been favourite verses. How do they take us to the heart of the wise life? I mean, how does this chapter describe the consequences of trusting in the Lord or in our own ideas?
Well, in my own pilgrimage, I've always felt that Proverbs basically is the law. It's still the law connected with the Old Testament concept, and that if we don't move from Proverbs to the message of grace, which we have in the New Testament, salvation by grace, we're basically dead in the water because no one is going to live up to all this, just like the Sermon on the Mount. So I think it's so important as people study the Word of God, and I often challenge people to read the whole Bible. At least 50% of the people in our churches today, especially youth, never read the whole Bible once. So I offer a free study Bible for anybody to read the Bible in 1 year. That's costing me quite a bit. But we can't just have Proverbs in an isolated way. We've got to go and see the message of Jesus, redemption and grace. And that's just important as we especially think about trust. And we think about these strong verses, because the Lord disciplines those he loves as a father.
Exactly. His
son he delights in.
Yes.
That jumps us up, doesn't it, to Hebrews chapter 12. And it's great to go back and forth between key passages in the Old Testament and passages in the New Testament.
There has to be this tie-up always. As we look at, I'm now looking on actually 3:16, where Proverbs promises long life and prosperity. And I suppose although following this wisdom that we read about may well bring some measure of such blessings, actually if we think of Jesus who died so young with few material possessions, is there more to these promises than just that?
I know. Some people read this and they're just like, brilliant! This is how I can live to be 120 and be a multimillionaire. All in here. I'll just claim those promises and there they are. You're like, whoa, whoa, whoa. That's not what that's talking about. No, that's not what that's talking.
I want a new car.
I know. And people do that. They literally.
I meet them all the time.
You meet them all the time.
And you just have to repent of wrong attitudes.
It is wrong, though. It is wrong that they do that because, in a way, the whole book of Proverbs has just said, turn away from selfishness and greed and everything. And then a person's coming in saying, yes, but I can have spiritual greed. And that sort of, you're like, no. Remember the Abraham. The Lord said to Abraham, I have a land for you and life for you. And then Abraham went to that promised land. And did he think, right, that's it, I've got massive estate on the Mediterranean coast? No, he lived in a tent because he knew that the land that the Lord really was giving him was something much more than a few hundred acres on the Mediterranean coast. It was a city with foundations whose builder and maker is God. It's nothing less than the new creation. And the life, he's not wanting to live to be 120 or 150. It's the eternal life that the Lord, the long life that the Lord God gives us is everlasting life. So the Lord Jesus says the meek will inherit not just a big estate or to live to be 150, they'll inherit the earth and have everlasting life and will never die. So when people say, I want to have £1 million and live to be 150, I'll say, get your sights a lot higher. You need to have a vision of inheriting the earth and living forever. That's the promise of the gospel.
You should really think of Abraham, ended up with one cave and one son.
Yes.
When he'd been told, your descendants are going to inhabit the whole earth. Well, I suppose Proverbs is pushing us again and again to choose between the wisdom or the way of folly. Like the Happy Valley set that I remembered as a child in Kenya, the people who were just living for themselves there, the white, there was the Europeans there. And we missionaries' children, we didn't like them very much because they took no notice of us, uninterested in us, entirely interested in themselves. We were bored to bits by them. And so when I think of that, I'm challenged by Proverbs to say to myself, am I a contributor to this world's needs or am I a consumer? It's one or the other. See you next time.